First thing is, well, apologize not to be able to be there, but this week there is the IBOA meeting in Bologna, and I have to be here. So, in the case I'll agree to have this kind of this talk in this Monday to load you. And the idea is to try to explain to you a little bit from the newcomer's perspective to something a little bit more advanced. What is the IBOA? What is the IBOA is doing? And what is going to be the relation with SKJ in the future? Because we expect that SKJ is going to have a huge impact also in the IBOA. So some things maybe could be, I don't really know your profiles, so maybe there are things that are quite trivial or at the beginning, but the idea is to be able to cover all the history from the beginning to the current state and what is going to be, in my view at least, what is going to be the evolution. So what is the IBOA? The IBOA is really a framework to allow the people that are data providers in astronomy to share data and to share metadata along the different nodes. Basically, there are different organizations. They are trying to define standards in order how to get data, how to use it, how to share with the rest of the organizations, and me methods to be able to find them. So it's really a place to discuss ideas. There is no budget, centralized budget. So basically, every institution that is part of the IBOA has their own budget. But it's a fund that we are making use to agree on the ways to share our data to the rest of the community and try to do the life of the people easier because they are going to use the same standards connecting to different data providers. So as you can see, this is the partners of the IBOA, and you can find that basically most of the interaction that the people has with the IBOA is done at national level. So every country that is a partner of the IBOA has their own national virtual observatory. For example, there is one per country. There is one about for Spanish, the Spanish virtual observatory, that I know that the people from Granada is quite involved on that. Collaborating with the institution. And also every country had their own institution, the National Virtual Observatory unit, but also there are other cases where it's not possible. For example, in the case of ESA, or in this case also SKIO, we cannot be part because we don't belong to any particular country. So basically we are like another partner, but in the level of intergovernmental organization. Basically there are two. In the past, also ESO was part, but because of constant structure of the system, they are collaborating but no formal partners. So basically, this is the list of the people that are currently involved. Every link here has a page describing the activities, and this is a nice way to see who is involved and in which people you can collaborate in case you want to do some kind of collaboration project with another country. And the IBOA is. You ask the people what is the IBOA, the people usually say that it's a set of protocols or set of tools, but it's not really that. It's the similar unit that is closer to that is W3C. So in the IBOA, we are defining the standards. Different kind of standards that are basically to do different things with the astronomical data, but it's a standard. So we don't have really a budget to develop tools or to create protocols. But in order to ensure that one standard is fulfilling and can be used, every standard that you have, you produce or you propose, need to have at least two reference implementations. That implies usually that you are able to cover the client and the server side in this case of a discovery protocol. So basically, you have to ensure that everything we are producing can be implementable. And this is where you enter with the tools and the server implementations. But basically, it's not really tools. It's standards. The idea is that there is a cycle from the working draft to proper recommendations to have a formal recommendation, and then there is some kind of connection to the IAU in order to do possible endorsement of the protocols that are really more general that can be endorsed by the general community of astronomy. This standard is quite difficult to describe all the work that is there. So basically, we created at the beginning some kind of architecture to define where to put the things. It was complex. And we created this at this somehow an architecture with different layers. I'm trying to put the protocols in the correct place. So basically, we have a protocols to discover data, that is in the getting part. So on the data access protocols, we have ways to discover services or data centers or whatever, that is the registry part, so discovery, the finding part of the architecture. There is a using part that basically things that are running in the client side. So for example, some to interchange information between tools or signals and nodes, for example. There are things that are more low level in order to share information, for example, the space that basically is storage for users. So they have their own storage in the data center. And in the middle, you have the different core elements that are creating this kind of infrastructure. Basically, you have data models that are quite important in order to homogenize the different ways to express astronomical data. You have query languages that typically the most known is ADQL. In order to do queries. You have semantics, that basically is, instead of going to data model side, is basically the kind of a unit or kind of a magnitude that you have there, so not with a link with the data model, but it's a semantic interpretation. And the formats, that are basically the how you express the different, how you serialize the different astronomical data. There are a set of entry points that are you can use. The main one is obviously the IBA portal. You have here in the documents side, you have the different standards that are recommendations and also the ones that are ongoing. So you have both things. And also you have here the architecture with description that have been done before, or how is the how we are creating the environment or architecture documents inside the BOI. So you have a full reference they can look into the distributed links. So then we go to a little bit to the typical IBA jargon. So there are a set of things that you are, if you connect to one channel about talking about Virtual Observatory or you have a session talking about the standards, you are going to hear very often because it's the typical thing that the people are making use of today. The more important thing, I think, in the IBA is the IBA table. I have to say that my first interaction with the IBA was trying to go to something more advanced than BioTable, but it's true that BioTable is everywhere. So basically, it's a table that is standardized with some kind of headers at the beginning. I will talk about it later. That contains basically information that you could need in the astronomical context to understand the different rows to access data. The HIPS, I'm also going to talk about it a bit about it later, is a format for images, but it's to create maps, basically, of the sky, using very big mosaics. So you're able to create like a Google Maps of the sky with this. The concept was originally of the IBA. Basically, there are a set of concepts, basically, in discover sources on what section of the sky, in a circle in the sky. It was important because it was the first time that we try to get a standard to discover data in the astronomy that are standardized. So it was the first protocol fully defined by the BOA. One that is probably you know, that is the TAP plus ADQL. TAP is the protocol to access tabular data in databases, basically. And ADQL is a language that incorporates astronomical objects. OSCOR and OSTAP is basically the new way to discover observations from different institutions. So it's a very simplistic observation description, and you can discover within the same data model observation from different data centers without modifying the query. That's very important. And also about alerts, intelligent data, and view events. That's something that is quite used in order to cover a little bit the transient astronomy that is quite relevant. There are many more. The way to discover lines, spectral lines, the way to discover images, spectra, provenance metadata, basically that characterize, for example, one observation, what is behind, how to interchange images between tools. So there are many more, but then these ones on top are the ones that you need to know. Whenever you hear this concept, you have to understand what it means because it's the one you are going to see, you want to listen more often. So the first thing I'm going to talk about is the is hips. So basically, in astronomy, you usually generate images from different sections of the sky. And it was like a challenge to create a mosaic at the beginning. So, and also it was difficult to represent or navigate these mosaics. So there was an initiative to create some kind of a standard of this kind of mapping. So basically you have a set of images and you can generate a mosaic that in some cases is covering the whole sky. And basically the key is creating the different layers of resolution. So whenever you navigate in a tool, this map, you are able to zoom in, zoom out. And whenever you are zooming, you are going to a different level of resolution, getting more details. Basically, it's a way to ensure that you're able to visualize the full sky in one browser. That was at the beginning a challenge. Well, I'm going to explain a little bit one example. But first, I'm going to explain about the technicalities behind. I don't know if you remember that at the beginning, Google tried to do this Google Sky thing, and they used the same projection to do the Google Sky than they have from the Google Maps. And obviously, it was done by people that were very clever, but they don't know a lot about astronomy, because in astronomy, the poles are important. They know in there, the poles are not quite relevant, but in the sky is not the case. The good thing is that HIPS is based in HILPIX. And HILPIX is isomorphic. So basically all the areas have the same aspect and same importance. So basically you have an sphere, you can divide in four, then in 16. So it's divided in by four. And you can go to the level of resolution that you want. And basically the HIPS is doing the same. Basically you have a level that is the static images at the end of the first level, then the second level, so you can go to the level of the real resolution of the images. So basically when you generate a HIPS, the system is going to start with the top level, generating more, and stops whenever you have the resolution of the original data. And you can see in the same, with the same resolution, and with the same quality, the poles and the equator, and you can even change the projection. So it's more applicable for astronomy than the what we have been seeing in Google Sky, for example. And now I'm going to do a small demo using Isa Sky. Well, Isa Sky was a tool that I'm working now for Sky job, but I've been working many years in Isa. And this is a tool that I defined with the other people at Isa that is making use and sharing information in his format, catalogs, observations, and whatever. I'm going to go to the HIPS file, and you can see that you can select different skies. You can select, for example, the nautical pieces, and you zoom out. You can see that it's going to different resolution levels. Well, it's not very clear, but you have here the full sky, and you can zoom in. It's not always the case that you have the full sky. So I'm going to change, for example, to okay, I think that could be okay, and change to galactic. Right, let's get to the point. So this is basically a composition of the image of Herschel, that was a satellite observing in infrared. And you are able to, this every time, every part, fraction of this part of the sky is a different observation. So at the beginning, it was almost impossible for Herschel to have a view of the full mission in one visualizer, but creating a HIPS file, HIPS format of the observation, you can explore it. And basically, this is the galactic plane. That's interesting because, for example, you can see some kind of star formation areas where there is a compression of the gas. So this is something that at the beginning was almost impossible to see, and in basically with generation of the HIPS, it was immediate. I'm going to go to a different place. You can add new skies. For example, you can ask the inertical pieces, and you can ask, for example, something in ultraviolet. Okay, and we can go, for example, to N51. It's a good example of what you can do with Gibbs. Okay. So the good thing of this is that you have this kind of scroll, for example, and you can pass from one. From one, I can even ask. So you can see that the same object, N51 and A and N51 too. You know that A and B, sorry, there are two colliding galaxies. There is one is dwarf one that is collided with N51 and 1A. And this is when you can see the importance of this kind of Higgs very easy exploration. So it's not, so you can go to infrared, you can go to optical, for example, you can go to ultraviolet, and you can see that N51B is not really emitting too much in ultraviolet. And also, you can see in this rays that there is a black hole in the center of both galaxies. So, with a very basic super overimposition of different images, you can identify things that are interesting to do science afterwards. It's not that you are going to use the Higgs to do the science. You cannot start the count because it's going to be misleading. But you can get ideas. You can explore the images and you can get information that led you to initiate one certain investigation. For example, in this case, the fact that it's not emitting in ultraviolet in the same way in both galaxies is because the population is has different ages. So that's something that you have an interpretation, and then you can go to the different parts of the sky and do the calculation. And this is where you can use Higgs. Higgs is an exploration step that you are doing preliminary to do the real science afterwards. But it's a very nice way to have ideas, to get ideas, and to understand what is in the original images that you are dealing with. So we can go to the Pleiades, and I want to later to say why. And you can see here the Pleiades. Now you are a astronomical fan, you know a lot of them, and you can see that it's mainly nautical because it's not really interested in most of the other wavelengths, but in nautical is quite nice because it's quite something visible for me. And then I'm going to connect to the rest, the second part of the presentation. Okay. So the first thing is, are you able to use Higgs, or you are able to create Higgs? It's really strong, it's Higgs. Basically, if you have images in Higgs format, it's very easy to create your own Higgs. And it's not only for publication. Maybe you have a set of images from the same part of the sky, and using the Aladdin Beta jar with a very simple Java instruction, you are able to generate your Higgs format of these images, your mosaic, and you are able to display that that in Aladdin. So that is a very nice way, easy way to try to see a visualization of the all your images in one map. In case you want to publish, because you have something that is more closer than a survey, you can also edit one Higgs description file, and you can go directly to publish it. So it's totally open. So you have something that is makes sense to publish, you can do it using this instruction. It's quite easy, so it's something that everyone can go. And this path, just to visualize in Aladdin, I have done it many times because it's quite interesting to do it for most sites. Then tables, bio tables. As I said before, this basically is a table that is in bio format that contains some kind of header that is standardized. You have coordinate system information. You have also time origin information about the kind of reference. So you have U types. U types is a connection to a data model. So basically, it's a meaningful interpretation of what is in one column. You have bio-units and units that are also standardized. So basically, when you have a unit, you know, you understand what it means. And you have data links. That's basically the way to download data from this initial exploration step. So basically, it's the typical thing you are using, is used by all the protocols in discovery. You can use, you can have different visualization in the output, but for sure, if you have a bio protocol, bio tables want to be one. And then how do you explore catalogs in general? What you use is basically the tab service. That service is a REST service. It's a URL you can interact with. And you are going to put as input an ADQL query. An ADQL is like an SQL query with some advanced features. And you receive in return a view table with some metadata. ADQL is a service like an SQL. Basically, it's very similar to SQL, you know, SQL, with some kind of geometrical operators, for example, point, is point in the sky. You can also generate circles. In this case, for example, is very easy. What you are doing is, okay, you are doing like a concert. You are looking a circle around a certain position in the sky, or the center radius, and you calculate the distance from this source to the to a certain position in the sky. So basically, it's like a concert query. In general, the ADQL syntax, you can see that is very similar to ADQL, to SQL, sorry. But the difference is that you are not inserting, updating, or whatever. It's basically the address select part. That is done in purpose to protect the system. So just because you are able to select things, and you want to put a table in the system, it depends on the task server. There are certain ones that are able to do it, the task plus, for example, but it's not the normal way to do this. It's designed to be to do selects on the catalogs. Okay, there's another typical query. And this is a cross match. This is quite important because you have a couple of catalogs and you want to discover counterparts in the two catalogs. I have removed here the first ICRS because this is just to say that we are evolving from 1.2.0 to 2.1. So in this case, we are preventing to put ICRS, but basically the same. You get a point, you get a circle. You usually put a circle in the smaller catalog because it contains several sources, obviously. And you say, give me the points in this catalog, the first one, in this case, the Gaia one, that are inside a circle around the positions of the second catalog. And give me, for example, the top 1,500. So in this case, you are able to do a cross match in one ADQL sentence. Very easy. And ADQL TAP is not only for catalogs, it's also to discover observations. So this, as I said before, this OSCOR format that basically is an observation metadata. So you're discovering here, for example, observation from a certain project where there are in a certain part of the sky, even a certain limitation in energy. So this AEM is the electromagnetic axis. And also in constraints in the time. So basically, you are able to discover source observations, and it's an extension of the normal source catalog. Well, so I'm going to go back to the Pleiades because there is a tab exercise on this. You know that Pleiades has an open star cluster, the middle-aged stars. It's, you know that it's close to Taurus, and it's a separated group of stars that belongs to a certain, it's not visual, it really belongs to a certain open cluster. So they have certain relation between them. That's important because they are in the similar distance and also they are moving together. There was a controversy about what is the distance to the Pleiades, and what we're going to calculate now. In Gaia, for example, they don't call distance, they talk parallax because it's the way the measure is parallax, and usually this is the conversion, but they don't want to say it in this way because the conversion requires certain calibration, but it basically is you have the parallax, it's more or less the distance in parsec inverse. And you calculate that the parallax for the distance that you can find in Wikipedia or in the different places is about 7, if the parallax is 7.4 milliseconds. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to reproduce this in TopCut using using tab. Okay. So this is TopCut. If you don't know it, I recommend you to install it. It's a very powerful application to handle with tables, and it's view compliant. Basically, you go here, you can open the tab query. You can find tables that have Gaia data. You can find there are many. One important thing is this server, the tab this year, that it contains, and you can see 53,000 tables. So it's the typical place where you can publish the tables. But this is the official one. This is the one that is published by ISA. Basically, you click here and you can use this tab server instance to do queries. And this is the query that the typical query where we are going to run is I think the same one. Yeah. But basically is I know the position of the Pleiades and put a circles or a circle of two seconds, I think, around the position of the Raya catalog. So basically I'm going to query about sources that are close to the position of the Pleiades. And also I'm trying to here to put a constraint that in order to remove sources that don't have a clear parallax measure. That can happen in many cases whenever it is very bright or very faint. So removing the ones that are not really calibrated. You do the query here. This connecting to the tab server to TISA, doing the query, and it's going to return the sources. Usually don't take too much. Okay, it was a bit scared. Okay, this is we have done the query that has 16,000 rows, and when we can start to visualize it. This is all the rows, but what we want to do is a visualization of the proper motions, rounded. So in this case, you can see the things that are moving together. Most of the things are related to the galactic plane, the galaxy, so they are working around zero. But if we do this kind of, you can see there is a black point here. So there is some kind of a structure. Right here. And this is the open cluster, this is the Pleiades. So you can see that this is the proper motion is not the one from the galaxy. It's a group of stars that are going together. So basically you can select these ones. And then this is the co-moving stars. No? Okay. And then we can move all. And this is the ones that we have. No? And then we can try to represent on this table and also only the co-moving. We can represent the parallax. Okay, I'm going to do. You can see that this is the sources of the play, but plus there are some outliers. So we want to remove these outliers. And the way to do it is you can get the co-moving, or you can add a new one. That is the Pleiades. And the expression is basically is like this, a little bit TopCut-like. That is basically you select the subset and you select the limits of the parallax. Okay. And then for this, you can just calculate the statistics. And you can see that the power loss is 7.35. Okay. We can continue with that. So there's a repetition of this. It depends a little bit on how you have defined the subset. You can define it, but you have done a calculation of the distance to the Pleiades, basically in a couple of minutes. And you go to a paper that has been published in a normal publication. You can see that this application just to calculate this with a local calculation that is basically the same. So you can you have reproduced a paper, a normal paper, in a question of a couple of minutes because you are using a Dio standard. So the next thing is basically the question is may I want or could I publish my own TAF server because I have a catalog or have a survey and I want to make public. So it's trickier, but it's possible. The normal thing is that you have a catalog, you could contact your national virtual observatory institution, or you can even send to VCL and they are going to publish to you by you. But the question is that probably the prominence of your catalog is not going to be so visible. You want to have two full control of the versions. Basically, the task server contains a toolkit that is creating the server, the REST service. You need to have a database that contains information. Usually, the people use the Postgres. You need to have a PHP module that basically is the one that is going to speed up the queries of the DQL. And you need to ingest the tables information about the your catalog, basically. This, if you have all these things, you are able to create a TAF server. And this is in this linter put here, there are documentation of how to get this information. So basically, my recommendation is the last time I used this kind of toolkits, I use 906. Probably there are new versions, but I'm not sure that it's going to work very well with PHP. You can try. But basically, you can take install a Postgres database. You can install a PHP that is also documented in different places. It's not so difficult. Even if you have Ubuntu, there is a way to install both things in one try. So it's quite easy. And the second thing, the task service, I said before, there are different toolkits in the IBA. One is for Gabo, the DAX that is used by many people. I like a lot the TAP Tutor, not because I'm an author, because I'm not, but because it's quite very well documented. You can follow the steps very easily without knowing too much about engineering even. There is always the last version of DQL because the engineer on charge of the TAP Tutor is also the one that is on charge of the DQL. And also makes use of Tonka server, which is quite something that is very easy to install. And so if you don't have even one already, it's quite easy to put a TAF server live in question of some minutes. And in case you don't want to go to this stage, just basically if you want to learn a little bit how is a TAF server in your site, I did some kind of Docker approach in the past, not for the general TAP, but also only for Oslock TAP. Oslock is a way to expose proposals or observations in the planning or accept an observatory. But basically with this kind of, you have Docker, with this kind of six sentences, you are going to have in your local desktop a TAP server planning. So it's quite easy to, it's quite good to see, to take a look into that, to go to the database and see what is there, because you need to declare in some way the table you have there in something called the TAP schema. So it's a very good way, fast way to have something running very fast. Not probably for operations, but something running very easily, you know, to explore a little bit what is inside and have some kind of experience. If whenever you have you want to this, to publish this kind of task, it's totally open also in the same way that HIPS to publish in the LOBO registry or those registries. Basically, registries are like the yellow pages of the Victor Observatory. So whenever there is a tool trying to discover services, they are using a REST service that is below, but there is a web interface that you can enter there, and you can publish your own records if you have services. So it's very easy to be done. I think there are not, and also in case there are questions, you have a contact point, then you can ask if you are lost in one of the pages, in the steps. But But in principle, it's quite easy to be done by anyone. Then we pass to the thing that I have done this work with tools, but the people don't really want to use tools because even in the past, many people make use of the ABOA and they didn't know that they are using the ABOA because they are using tools that are using behind BIO protocols, but they don't see them. And then there was this exercise with AstroPy that tried to incorporate all the Python libraries that you could need to do the very basic astronomical analysis. And then there was an exercise by the ABOA to publish clients to all the different virtual observatory protocols that called PyBO, and also the different astronomical providers, data providers, publish their own methods in AstroQuery. So basically, this is a general library. This is the just to access BO protocols, and this is a totally data provider dependent function. So you're able with these libraries, you're able to discover data, use data, and it's quite well documented. And that was a step forward. For example, in remember that in Gaia, the stats is basically 80% or 90% of the queries comes from people making use of AstroQuery or PyBio models. So basically, whenever they send this code that they can do their own scripts and they can use this, they can make use of these protocols easy, incorporating in the scripts, it was like a new world for them, basically, because they understood everything, they are able to do very complex things. So I think that was a very important step forward. So I'm going to repeat a little bit the same exercise, but using, well, let's see if it was, I don't know if it's running. No. No, I don't know how many people connected or not. In the workforce case, I can go to the version that is in GitHub. Let's open this recovery. Well, there's a pity because I just thought there is some kind of problem with the server. But okay, I'm going to explain it a bit here what I'm doing. So the first thing is, it's a pretty good thing that you are able to install libraries. I think there are from a success that already prepared, that basically you are able to install AstroPy, AstroQuery, PyBO, the typical thing, NumPy, Matplotlib, so you can add statistics, for example. But that's not the typical thing you are making use whenever you try to query about BIO services. So the first thing is basically, well, in loading the libraries. It's this part that is very interesting because one of the parts of the query is Simbad. Yes. Simbad. Yes, yeah.
A moment, yes. We added in Slack a link to all Colab, and it's working better in the chat of BIO.
This one.
Yes, this one.
Okay,
yes. Let's save. Connect. Right, top. Yes. Yeah. Yeah, okay. You can run again. Okay. Yes, run away.
Yeah. It's not a major complaint. So, okay, this is, you can see that the system is loading the libraries you are going to use in the rest of the exercise. Okay, here you can import in the libraries. And here, this, as I said, this, the, you can have here the you can invoke Simbad, so you can, you are able to use a name and get the coordinates in return. And also you have also SkyCore, that is basically the way to understand the response from Simbad and to be able to get the run, the deck, different, in different fields and these kind of things. So basically you run it, you can see that it's invoking Simbad under the hood, and you have the coordinates from the PH. Here, you have the same thing, right? You are using PyBO to invoke the Gaia Tab server, the same thing, you have the service URL, you have the same query, the same SQL we had before, and you are able to run it in synchronous mode, and you are able to print the results, and you can see that the results are a little bit different, that's why you have less records, but this is the same kind of query. And then you can see in the scatter plot, you can represent the same thing, the proper motions in the two the proper motion run and proper motion take. And you can see here that is the co-moving player is here. And with some inspection, visual inspection in this case, maybe you can do it even better, but okay. You can define a little bit the limits and try to see if we are getting the correct number of stars. You can see them more or less is circular, that's quite well. So you are able to, you have been able to define the limits in RA and DEC that you can use in another query. In this case, instead of working in the client side and working doing queries to the tab server and putting the limitation here in this kind of coordinates or the proper motions to get the only the players. Okay, and you can see that and then the limitation of the number of rows, and you can represent an histogram with the parallax. You can see the same thing. You can see that there are outliers, so you don't want to get them. You just want to have the ones that are really in the player cluster because the other ones are closer or very far away. And you put a limitation in the queries for the parallax. Okay, this is the new subset. You discover now the parallax of this style. It's a lot better because you can see that they are more or less in the same distance. And using the studies, you can identify the parallax, the median, and you have a similar number. So basically, you have reproduced in a very fast notebook what has been done in TopCat and what has been done in the paper. So it's a very easy way to interact with the Victor Observatory libraries. So then I want to move to the what implies the SRCs and what is the changes that expect to be done in the IBO in the future. I'm going to be quite fast in this part because you know about this. You have had the morning the presentation from Filipa that is going to cover this thing. What is SKJ? What are the different antennas in the two places, two local locations? It's going to be unprecedented. The amount of data we are going to produce to be analyzed by the scientists. There are different numbers here, depends on who you ask, but it's between 500 to 700 petabytes per year. That's massive. That's massive talking about tsunami. And obviously, there is no country that is able to handle that. So basically, the idea is we are going to distribute the data in different nodes. There are going to be a lot of nodes. We have to ensure that the connectivity between the nodes is good enough in order to be able to work in harmony. And the idea is that, okay, we have the data distributed in a very big data lake across the planet. We have copies of the data only in certain places. So we're going to have two copies of every file, but you don't have, anyone is going to have the full copy of the scale data. That implies you have nodes that have to talk together. This is the numbers a little bit. Currently, there are 16 countries involved. One of them is Spain, the Spanish SRC, that is one of the most relevant partners we have. We are going to have more or less in development of around 100 FTEs between, I'm talking about only the people doing the international project in terms of development and also operations. So it's massive, the project. And we have data that is comparable to the main data holders of the planet. So we are talking about data that is comparable with can receive the Google searches, or you know the full Internet Archive, but is comparable with the main the data that provides for the plan. So it's a massive project for a science project. So that the question is that we have this kind of repository, this system distributed for the planet, and we cannot say that it's going to be only a repository. So the different SRC nodes need to have certain harmony in the software itself. They need to have shared capabilities, because we don't want that the people connecting to different SRCs, they have a totally different experience. They need to be able to run in a similar way workflows or whatever, and find data in different SRCs without depending that you're connected to one in South Africa or China or Australia or whatever. So this is why we had to find a set of capabilities that are the common ones. They had to be similar in the core of the system. We have the data management system, basically the data lake, and we have the resource processing, visualization, interoperability, the data discovery. So the basic things are going to be more or less homogeneous. But obviously, every country, every associated node can extend them and to be okay. Because I am expert in visualization, I want to have more visualization capabilities. But it's like an extension of a common, of a blueprint. And basically, these extensions that we are going to have in different countries and the protocols between them, so in order to work in a harmonized way, are what we call the SRC net. There are certain principles that basically, because the data is massive, we want to prevent unnecessary duplication and transfer. So we have to find ways that we don't move the data, that is tricky. We know that the people should not be able to download the data to the local desktops. So they should be able to work in the net, what implies certain limitation or certain compromise in the to be able to collaborate and also to reproduce the science use cases, because at the end, whatever you are doing, it should be reproducing the network. So we have to fulfill this need. And also because we don't want to reinvent the wheel and want to have agreements fast with the different countries, we want to use standards as much as possible. In this case, a standard is properly documented, you know, maybe you have implementation. So the idea is to make a standard whenever they are. You know, it's not always the case, but whenever they are, we are going to take one. We have multiple use cases, you know that. We can go to deep learning, we can analyze image data queues, that implies very big files, out of memory. We also need to have this kind of comparison of different energies with color matches. So we have many different things that implies also many heterogeneous and many different hardware installations to be able to fulfill the use cases. So it's a very complex system at the end. And the distribution, you know from this morning, the idea is that we are going to have data with different SRCs in different locations. We are going to have two copies in order to ensure that if one node is down, we were able still to have access to the data, and also in order to, this is a major disaster. But it's not too much, but we're going to have more data copies than two probably, because it's quite expensive. And in principle, the idea is that we have to put the data close to the people that had the proposal. And this makes sense to the proposal-based observations, not for the public data. But you know that is going to be not possible always, because you can even know that this team could be have different people in different countries, for example. So that implies that we are going to work and do our best effort to put the data in the core location, but it's not going to be the perfect location. If you want to do something that is implies data from different nodes, one idea could be to move the data to one particular execution node, but you know that we are trying to prevent this kind of movement of data. So the idea we are trying to sell is we should be able to do after data execution, basically to be able to secure different parts of your workflow in different places, creating like an API. So you are able to send one particular part of your execution, for example, to China, because it's in China where the data is. And you are going to have a social communication to get the result of your calculation at the end, to be able to do the execution in a harmonized way in all the different SRC nodes. So what implies this in the VA context? The VA context is, in the beginning, we have this kind of discovery and data access services, like I said before, this concert, SIAP, TAP. the people discover at a certain moment that they can integrate in the workflows. And this you know, has said before about AstroQuery, AstroPy, and we are here. Here is the point when the people started to create SaaS platforms, but the SaaS platforms are not able to talk each other. So the idea is, I foresee that the IBA is going to move to a way to interconnect the different SaaS platforms, and the same we are doing, and we are going to do in the SaaSinet, we are going to do the same, but for different projects. For example, connect SKA with LSST, and that implies that the API should be common. The idea is that at the end, you have what I call the democratic science, and so basically an ideal structure with humans and even AIs are able to use the system in a quite transparent way. Whenever there is a bottleneck, we have to remove it. That implies there should be a way to have a single login. There should be a way to discover this with the processing, interconnect the platforms, even probably connect the data lakes. So that should be the future. We are here, and we're trying to move here. So that is the first class. And this is what we're discussing this week, for example. So, okay, this is the typical SaaS platform. You have seen one architecture, one platform, you have something like this. You have an authentication layer. Usually the people even use their own LDAP. So this is not federated. They have a way to do interactive analysis, the Jupyter, that's very nice. Some people put this kind of big terminal interface that is with this Guacamole, that's you're able to open a terminal there. Here we have a patch processing, so you're able to send down jobs. And the authorization usually is local because you need to have control of who is using your system and who's accessing your data. That's okay. A software repository that some people use Next or whatever, that is also local. Orchestrators, that's typical thing, or Kubernetes for Socket or whatever, that's quite common. Computing they put OpenStack. In data, they usually have local repositories. And metadata, they are make use of tab server in many cases, so that in this way, the IBA is more prepared for the metadata approach. The idea is what had to be done, that something had to be done locally in SaaSinet, but also globally, is authentication that is going to be a federated one. That implies we need to, all the platforms in astronomy should use federated authentication, so the same approach. Probably we need to connect data lakes or repositories or different platforms. This is something we're going to do in SaaSinet, making use of the same data lake. That makes sense. You should be able to run jobs remotely. There's something that is going to call the federated execution, that is basically to define an API where you can send a workflow to be executed. And something that I'm foreseeing is instead of accessing the data, put remote services to run remote operations. The constructor level probably is complex to be done. Probably in SaaSinet we can do it, but talking with different SaaS platforms, with different projects is almost impossible. But what something can be done in the IBA is to have this kind of a federated software repository. So the federated data lake. I don't know if we're going to be able to standardize something at the IBA level. Basically, to have like a data lake in LSST, another one for NISA, another one for SKA, and to have some kind of like a common federated data lake, and you're able to discover in a very low-level data lake approach. But that could be something interesting, because in this way, you are going to have access to the full astronomical data in the same data lake. But I think this could be complex to be done, because you need to have agreements on the technology in some cases, and that could be complex. What I'm going to foresee is more a service approach. Basically, this is a service mesh approach, so basically the data is not only the data, it's only the code, the formats, and the infrastructure below. So that implies, basically this, is very understandable. You have a cube, and you move to a cube to a certain location, in Canada, for example, and you're visualizing the data in a particular place in South Africa, for example. You don't move the data, you invoke the operation remotely, and you only have the slicing return. This is something that the IBA can do, not only for SKJ, but we can do it for all the astronomical projects. They try to define these interfaces to the remote services. And the, what kind of services? You can, for example, in a cube, you can slide the cube, you can get the spectra, can see this. So you can do many things. For images, you can change the resolution in order to have a, something that's visible in your browser. You can extract sources from one image. It could be a service. You can, for example, convert one spectrum native format to something that is be compliant. You can, for example, identify similarities in sources. So you send an ID to one source and you can ask the system, give me a similar sources to this one. So there are things you can do it locally because the output is smaller than the input data. And it's something that we you are able to define this, all these kind of services. We are connecting not from local data in one massive data service mesh. Obviously, we need to have defined standard, not only one per one, but also like a standard to discover all the operations. And the same thing about the fetch execution. It basically, if we're able to define an API that is can be done, can be implemented below with abstraction to different platforms, you can connect the execution from different places. So you can do a workflow that implies data from SST, SKJ, Hubble, or James Webb, or whatever. And you don't move the data, just you just move the code and you get only the result. So that could be the next step I see, I foresee for the IBA. And the planner basically is something that we have proposed in the IBA already. That is, if you have a workflow to be executed and you have a certain software to be run, you have to understand the requirements in hardware, the requirements in data, and you are able to execute, to get all the information of the net, basically all the networks, all the site platform information about the connectivity network, the repositories, the computer resources. We store this in a system that is a global, not a system information system. And this is the information that the security planner is going to use in order to decide, okay, for this part fraction of the workflow, the best location to be used to execute this software is in this location, in this particular set platform. And we're able to do that, we're connecting all the platforms, astronomical platforms in the planet, using the same standard. And that could be, I think, in my view, a major step forward. So issues to be addressed in the next era of the IBA, for the authentication, we need to have a single sign-on for all the science platforms. We need to improve data access, not just doing queries and retrieving URLs. This is not enough. We need to do ready processing, maybe first doing this kind of remote operations approach, and maybe later to this kind of API. But it's something that the IBA has to address because the new era implies a lot of data and we cannot use the same paradigm of discover and retrieve. Another summary, I think the IBA is making use, is providing a lot of easy way to access data from the astronomical context. You can already run many astronomical use cases, very easy, as you have said before, in minutes you can do things that are very complex to be done. But you have the new step, the new era, that is basically converting the current structure of the IBA in protocols that are allowing connect science platforms and machine learning. Because this is going to be done in the SASINet, we can also help them to promote these protocols for the astronomical community in general. And when we have that, we are going to be able to do almost everything. So basically, you have to have an astronomical network for any kind of use case. And that's all. No, there is any question.
Hear me? Okay, no. Sorry, we have
okay.
No. with the sound here. Thank you so much for your very comprehensive presentation. I am sure this could be fleshed out into a multi-day workshop, actually, and I would be very interested to attend. I forgot to mention in the beginning that Jesus very generously offered for us to ask questions during, We are still here, and are there any questions for Jesus on any of the topics? Yes, Susanna.
I'm very interested in the this data mesh services. I think this is a complex or difficult concept, and if you can elaborate something more on that, because sometimes I cannot see the difference between this data mesh approach, data mesh services, than the remote operations. Can you?
Yes, so it's very similar, because the remote operation is something that we are used to using the VO in other contexts. The question here is that in the data mesh is more than a software selection, it's a paradigm. Basically, it's not just defining how to do the discovery, but also how to structure the teams that are in charge of this service. Basically, the data mesh is telling, okay, you cannot move the data, okay, you create services, you create a service mesh, you can use the energy you want. So in this case, remote operations could be okay, or a service mesh could be okay. But you need to have in the same team defining the operations, people experts in the data, people experts in the serializations, and also science data scientists, and also experts in hardware. So basically, you need to create a small team that is expert in all the areas, in all the layers, and this is the team that has in charge of defining the services. So instead of dividing the services, you create one team per, in this case, probably the prototype. That could be, for example, you create a team that is experts in cubes, and this is the one that is defining the services. And this is the one defining the clients also. So whenever you have a library, this is kj.cube, this is something that has been developed by the cube system, the cube team. So it's more apparent in how to divide the teams to make use of a complex data lake in more than the technical solution. The technical solution is very similar to SODA or to service mesh or something like that. It's quite similar. So the approach you follow is depending on your technical needs, but it's quite similar. It's basically how we can then make the division, the feature division of the teams in order to be able to create the services in a proper way.
But you are talking about teams, but I guess that is not only teams, also services. I mean, you distribute the data and the analysis services depending on the science cases, no? In order to group in different places things that are similar or that are complementary.
Yeah. The question is that you have a domain data team experts that contains all the layers, and they should be able to put metadata that characterize this use case or this method. So this information that basically say I need to be able to run this method, I need GPUs, I need storage of this kind, or I need to be able to have this kind of memory. So they describe the software also, and this is what is used in the dissemination to ensure that you disseminate the data to a place that is able to run that. So basically, it's a way to decouple the layers, creating teams that are experts in one particular area, but they should be able to characterize around all the methods what is needed in order to be executed. Because in case you move a data queue that is very big to a place that don't have GPUs, and you need GPUs to do some kind of analysis on the queue, for example, I don't know, to identify patterns or whatever, you can say, no, you have to put into a place where you are able to secure this particular method. In other case, you should not move the data there because there is going to be a bottleneck. So it's like a different way to work. This is something that is making use in many different companies. For example, Netflix is making use of that in order to put the streams of the movies or whatever in the correct place. They define different things depending on the resolution to something like Kafka modules in order to modify the stream, and they had to find the teams in this way. So the different kind of experts in different areas, and they had divided the teams in a way that they are able to define the software self-consistent and put in the correct place. And it's something that is in a problematic division that this SRCnet could be very, very beneficial, because it's a technical solution, but also a bureaucratic structure to put the things in the correct way.